Hello, 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 and thank you for listening to another episode of the Keto Answers podcast. Today, I had on a special guest, Chris Irvin. He is the first person to be on the show twice, and today was a good one. We ranted pretty excessively about what to do when you're stuck on a plateau on ketosis. So if you're trying to lose weight and you don't know what to do, this episode is for you. We went through stepwise function, everything you need to do to figure out what is in your way to help lose weight faster. So if you're interested in that, tune in and I hope you enjoy. Before we get to the episode, I wanted to chat about our sponsor, Perfect Keto. Perfect Keto is all about making a ketogenic diet healthy and accessible. Whether you're reading all of our online guides or articles or enjoying Perfect Keto's exogenous ketones or any other keto-friendly products, everything you need to make keto work for you is at perfectketo.com. I know what you're thinking. Hey, aren't you the founder of Perfect Keto? Yep, that's right. And all of my insanely high standards have been put into making each and every product. My background as a functional medicine clinician helps me craft the cleanest and healthiest possible products and the best information about the ketogenic diet. Head on over to perfectketo.com to learn anything you need to know about the ketogenic diet. And if you've never tried any of our products before, feel free to use the code KETOPODCAST for 20% off your first order. With that being said, let's get into the show. Chris, thanks for coming on the show, my man.
Thank you for having me, Dr. Gustin. How are you doing today?
Great. Fun fact. First of all, Anthony's cool. Please call me Anthony. Yeah, fun fact, you are the first repeat guest in the show.
Really?
Yeah, I think we're
That's quite the honor.
Yeah, we're mid-30s and you're the first repeat other than me being solo a couple of times. You're the first person to be on twice. So, yeah,
Dang, that's awesome.
You were one of the most downloaded episodes before and we were chatting the other day and you were chatting about one of the things you were working on, which is the thing that I probably get questions about maybe 7 to 10 times per day, every single day. And so I thought, what better if you've thought about all this stuff to come on and strip it all down and give people all the help that they need. So that topic would be getting stuck on what's called a plateau on keto or a weight loss plateau. And so this is something where literally 7 to 10 times a day, I get a question on Instagram or my email that says, hey, here's what's going on. I did keto for X amount of months. I'm hitting these macros and I'm stuck at a plateau. I'm not having any progress. And there's so much to unpack here. So I don't even know where to start, but one of the biggest things that I notice is that people just, some of the times just aren't that patient. And I think that this is one of the biggest things to focus on is just patience in all of this and make sure that it's not something that you need to freak out about if it's 2 days and you're not losing weight. And so let's just cleanly clarify for people what is and is not a plateau. So I'm just going to go out and say that, like if you're tracking weight, and I don't know what your recommendations are, so we can go about this, but I would say average out your weight throughout a week. So I would say, you know, if you're weighing yourself and things are tracking down, you know, we can talk about body composition and all this different stuff in a little bit, but body fat obviously is the best. But if you're doing this stuff, average out your weight over the course of a week and then compare weeks 1 and 3, 2 and 4, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you're looking at not a seesaw swing of day to day and you're not looking at a seesaw swing from week to week. And so that way you get enough time where you can look at trends over a long period of time and see your body adapt over a long period of time instead of freaking out. Maybe you drink a lot of water the day before. I don't know. So what is your thought on, I guess, what a plateau is and how people should know step one if they've actually hit a point where they should be concerned?
Yeah, well, I think that we kind of have very similar views on this, but I kind of a rule of thumb for me is that if you're in your first like month of keto, like first 4 to 6 weeks, chances are you're not at a plateau because I don't think that you've really had enough time to adapt to the diet to say that you've plateaued.
That's a good point.
I think a lot of times, like you nailed it on the head, where people think they're stuck at a plateau because they're used to that. They think that first week of keto where they lose that 3 to 7 pounds because of all the water and glycogen that's coming out. I think they tend to think that that's going to continue that same trend of losing weight that rapidly. And when it doesn't, I think people tend to feel that that means that they're stuck at a plateau. So I always kind of tell people, like, if you're in your first month and you went the last couple weeks of this month without seeing progress, you're not stuck at a plateau. I think that you probably just need to kind of, you know, dial it in and wait a little bit longer and see as your body goes through these changes. But I do think that's kind of the biggest thing is like really identifying, are you stuck at a plateau or are you not quite seeing that the same progress you were expecting? Or like your case, you said, you know, the fluctuations that can happen from, you know, having more water or having more calories one day or, you know, exercising or not exercising. There's just kind of a lot of components that come into play. So kind of another thing that I'll tell people too is really like, don't weigh yourself every single day either. A lot of people, you know, if they weigh themselves on Monday and then they weigh themselves on Friday and that number is different, then they think they had a bad week. I think it's kind of one of those things where you should stay away from the scale for a few weeks at a time and kind of assess your progress that way to see what those changes are more long term.
So if somebody is concerned, am I at a plateau or not at a plateau? What is the general rule of thumb then?
Well, I think I think general rule of thumb is that if you're over, you know, if it's been over 4 to 6 weeks, you've been doing keto for a while, and then you've had at least 2 to 3 weeks where you know you're kind of been following a similar training program or a similar dietary program, and you're not seeing any results, then I think that that's probably the result of a plateau. Now, you know, determining what is seeing results is kind of hard because, you know, a lot of times people go by the scale, and we know that if you're, you know, the scale isn't necessarily always going to be the telltale sign for if you're stuck at a plateau. So I really like to tell people that something to consider when assessing if you're in a plateau is also like how you feel. I mean, if you're seeing a little bit of progress and you're still, you're feeling great, your energy levels are up, you don't have a ton of cravings, then again, I wouldn't consider that to be a plateau. But if you have seen just, you know, absolutely no results and you're, you know, now you're starting to strip calories away, I think that's kind of the telltale sign for a lot of people is, you know, if you're down to 1200 calories a day, and you're, you know, exercising 6 times a week and not seeing results, like that's about as much of a plateau as you can be stuck at, I think.
Right. So what then would be your first initial thing, questions? Again, let's say I say I'm doing keto for a couple of months, here are my macros, and I'm stuck at a plateau. What's your first line of advice here?
Yeah. So really, first things first, like you said, is it's kind of figuring out if they're tracking their macros. You know, one of the things I always find with people is people who aren't tracking their macros, maybe they did for a while and then they stopped, or maybe they were following like a lazier keto where they were just eating the approved foods, but not necessarily looking at calories or carbs. The first thing I'll usually tell them is to assess at least your carbohydrate intake, because a lot of times I'll see people where they think that they're consuming 20 to 30 grams of carbs, but really that they might be up to, you know, 50, 60 grams, because I kind of call it the carb creep. Like we let those carbs creep up. And sometimes that's a result of kind of that transition from tracking net carbs into total carbs, or I'm sorry, go from total carbs and net carbs, where sometimes people will let those carbs creep up higher because of that too. So really the first thing I was
to go into there, do you recommend people track net or total?
It's a good question. I get that question so much. And I always say that if you're stuck at a plateau or you're new to keto, I recommend doing total, because I think that if you do net, what happens is those total carbs, like sometimes people will, you know, they'll squeeze in, it'll be 20 to 30 grams of sugar, and then, you know, that, but their net carbs are still low enough and, you know, their total carbs are at 50. So I think that if you're like new or you're stuck at a plateau, you should go total carbs and keep them low. But, you know, if you're pretty well adapted and you're seeing good results, you might be able to push that envelope a little bit and do net carbs. I'm probably more on the net carb train, but, you know, I also don't eat too many carbs that aren't fiber related. So I think it really depends on the individual. But, you know, if you're at a plateau, we got to get those carbs down, chances are.
Okay. So tracking macros, good. Let's say somebody's tracking macros. What are the next few steps that you like to get to?
Yeah. So the next thing is looking at the types of food you're having. So if you're, I mean, I always tell people, if you want to take the number one best approach when stuck in a plateau to figuring out, I mean, really, I guess to go into it, what the goal here is that we're trying not to cut calories right away. I probably should have pretensed this with that. But I think a lot of times what we tend to do is we hit a plateau and the only thing we know to do is either exercise more or eat less. And if we're already exercising a bunch, everybody just cuts those calories back. So kind of the first, like in my mind, what I always, the two things I'm trying to do is figure out, is there something related to the food that you're eating? You know, after we assess the carbs, is there something related to the food we're eating? And is there a way that we can stimulate more calorie burning? Those are kind of the two biggest things. So to go on one of those tangents, you know, one of the biggest things that we see as a hang up with people is dairy, for instance. Like I've seen a lot of people who I think it's something what like 75% of the population doesn't possess the enzymes necessary to digest dairy. So, you know, it's pretty common that we see a lot of people inflamed from consuming a lot of dairy, and that can be one of the biggest things that's kind of hurting your results. So I always tell people, if you want to just take, if you want to kind of guess at it, you know, cutting dairy is probably going to be one really good way to bust through a plateau. But if you want to get really specific, I think that taking a food sensitivity test is the way to go. Have you ever done a food sensitivity test?
Yeah, I'm a little partial to the types of tests being done here, because a lot of the food sensitivity tests are dependent on your gut and your gut integrity. So for example, if you have a bunch of gut lining problems and a lot of stuff that's getting in your bloodstream that shouldn't be, your body will go, oh yeah, you have these food sensitivities, and people cut them out for the rest of their lives. Well, if you just restored your gut function, then you wouldn't have those things floating around your bloodstream. Your body wouldn't react to them the same way. And so that's one of those things that we're like, I'm a little hesitant on some of them for some of the reasons, but some of them are actually pretty legit. So what is your point of view here?
Yeah, I agree with you. I think that, yeah, like leaky gut and everything like that can definitely be a contributor to what's going on with those sensitivity tests. I actually had a really good talk with a good friend of mine, Dr. James, who he is a professor at a school in Missouri, and he does a lot of food sensitivity testing. One of my questions to him was like, you know, the type of testing that they do is the one where basically they're recognizing these enzymes that are popping up as a it could always be a result of if you're consuming a lot of those foods. So like my biggest question to him was, you know, if we see that you have a bad reaction to chicken, is it because you're eating a lot of chicken, or is it because you actually have a bad reaction to the chicken? And he kind of brought up an interesting point that changed my perspective on it a little bit, because I was pretty skeptical too. And it said, like, if we go down this list and we say, you know, we take this food sensitivity test, we get a list of 10 to 15 foods that are causing problems. I think it's a good place to start with looking at, okay, which of these foods am I consuming the most of? And if I cut them out, can I cut them out for a while, restore my gut health, lower my inflammation, and start seeing results again? So I think it's one of those things where it's definitely not something that we can clear cut, tell exactly what we need to do from the results, but it can at least give us a good idea of where we can start in terms of eliminating, at least in the short term, some of these foods.
Yeah, that's a good point. And one of my first recommendations for people when they say, I have a few, but the first one is, are you eating real food?
Yes.
This whole dirty keto thing and people eating just bullshit is I cannot tolerate any longer. And I think that now every single episode in the last 4 or 5 months has at least one mini rant from me about this, but you cannot expect to be burning and using fat and being a healthy human being when you eat shitty foods. Like that's right. Just plainly clear. So I would say that that's the first thing. Like, does your food generally spoil? And if the majority of food doesn't spoil, you need to start there. And I think that dairy is one of these things where you're right. It's an easy thing to avoid that a lot of people have trouble with. So I'll throw that in there as a caveat to add on. Cause I mean, it is, I would say, a real food, but are you getting raw dairy or is it cheese sticks that can last in your fridge for 4 years? You know, this is a very different thing. So what comes after food sensitivity and the food quality for you?
Yeah, well, that's actually kind of the big one is once we're looking at, like, I always tell, I mean, basically when I go through somebody busting through a plateau, my goal is to kind of have the minimal effective dose to start. So, you know, I'm always kind of trying to promote the ability to follow keto as a lifestyle too. So, you know, rather than going through, like, we can go through and figure out what the most optimal diet is, but that doesn't mean that it's the one that you can best stick to. So, you know, that's why I usually start with recommending something like cutting out dairy, because like you said, the majority of dairy that's out there is pretty low quality. So if we can, you know, cutting that out alone might be enough to start seeing progress again. So if we can just eliminate that right away and see progress, that might be enough for the short term. But if that doesn't work, I think food quality, like you said, is a big one. That's usually the next step that I look at. And actually, you know, before I get into food quality, I'm going to finish touching on one other one before I get into that. One of the things I like to tell people to do before they get into calorie restriction is, can we stimulate more calorie burning? So I think a lot of times we get people who come to keto and they're not exercising, and the people who aren't exercising, you know, you can see a lot of great results from keto without exercising, but eventually your body, I think, is going to adapt. It's going to stop seeing some progress. And, you know, rather than trying to cut the calories, I think if we can stimulate more calorie burning by, you know, maybe changing the type of exercise we're doing to more high intensity training, or in some cases, just putting in exercise into your routine in general, I think can be a big thing. So that's kind of part of like the initial stage for me when trying to bust through someone's plateau is, can we be burning more calories without overtraining? Can we be cutting out foods, and can we, you know, prevent ourselves from creeping up with those carbohydrates? And then, you know, after that, that's kind of when the next step, it's like, if you start doing those things and that's not working, I think it's time to start looking at some of those lifestyle factors, like your overall food quality.
Right.
You kind of nailed it. Like, people, you can see great results. If you're coming from a traditional Western diet where you're eating McDonald's every day, You can come do dirty keto, this quote unquote dirty keto, and see great results for a few weeks. But that's just because you're coming from a diet that's way worse than that. It doesn't mean that it's necessarily the best diet. So for a lot of people, I think food, like you said, food quality is a thing. Like if you're eating processed lunch meat and cheese sticks, and that's kind of your snacks every single day, then you probably need to take a step back and see if we can improve your food quality. So I definitely like taking that approach, like you said.
Yeah. And a point to make on the calories perspective and you with burning more calories and things like that. I am not necessarily of the camp one way or another that, you know, you get this opposed position of people where they say calories are all that matter. Just make sure that you burn more than you consume. And I think that is total bullshit. And I think that also this on the other side of the stick, some people say that calories just don't matter at all. That's just completely hormonal and it just does not matter. And like you should never count calories. And I don't think that's true either. And so what happens is just like a car, to some degree, like if you drive a car like an idiot and you should be getting 35 miles per gallon, for instance, on gas, if you drive it like a fool, you'll get 20. But it's still like it still matters how much fuel you put in the tank and how much you're burning, right? And so if you're never burning anything, well, then you can easily overfill that tank. And that's kind of what working out and exercising is as well. And so you're never using any of that fuel. And not only that, one of the things that exercise does a lot that I think people realize is it tells your body what to do a lot with its free time, right? And so stimulating a lot of signaling molecules of saying, hey, I need a lot of repair in these muscle tissues. Put a lot of energy over here instead of storing it. And so instead of storing it, you start using it more and more and more. So I don't see it as much of like a direct, you know, get on the treadmill and burn another 100 calories. That to me has never seemed like a thing that's worked. More so to me, exercise as a way to stimulate signaling molecules and do some strength training has been a way more effective long-term approach. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. And I think anybody who has, like, I fall in the same realm as you where I think the calories are important, but not the most important. They play a role for sure. But I think for anybody who makes the argument that they're the only thing that matters, you know, how come we can look at somebody who's, you know, 25% body fat consuming, you know, they're well over 200 pounds consuming, you know, 1200 calories, but working out 6 days a week and they're not seeing results. You know, it's pretty obvious that the calorie concept isn't really at play here. So, and that's really one of the things that in general, I think keto's so fascinating with, because like you said, there's a lot of signaling that can happen from a ketogenic diet. And, you know, just in general, improving like mitochondrial function can do a lot for our metabolism and our ability to burn more fat. And that's kind of why, like, you really can't put a number on things like that. Like where does my metabolism differ from yours in terms of our mitochondrial function or our levels of insulin sensitivity and things like that? Like there's just so many factors at play. So that's kind of why with diet in general, it's such an individualized approach. There's really no telltale sign. Like for anybody who's, you know, coaching anybody, if you're using a calculator to determine how many calories somebody should be eating and using that as the only thing, the only thing you're taking into consideration, chances are you're just not taking enough thought into other factors that might be at play.
Right. And so I think it can be useful to set that, because what happens otherwise is that people just generally don't have consistency in their day to day. And so I do think that there's a lot of utility to setting, especially if you have a goal and to be able to measure things on a day-to-day basis and hit something consistently. Like consistency over time is what gets people results. And whether that's you're trying to pick up a new habit or a new skill or lose weight, whatever, it doesn't matter. I think that consistency over a long period of time and having patience is what get people goals generally. Obviously, there's a lot of different factors with losing weight, but it's one of these things where like setting macros and calories are a way to stay consistent. They're not a rule or a law that you must stick to no matter what.
Right. Yeah. And I think that's probably the biggest issue with any diet. I mean, whenever we start telling ourselves that, you know, this is exactly how much of this I can have and I can't have anymore, or these are foods that I can't have anymore, we just start to develop a negative relationship with food. And that's when things become a diet. So I think like that is something that's important. I think it's good to have an idea of, you know, this is kind of roughly what a day of eating looks like for me. These are what my macros should be around, but also kind of having the adaptability to look at it. And if you go a little bit over, you're a little under on something, you're not going to freak out about it. So I think that kind of of goes along with that lifestyle concept that we talk about so much.
Right. So what are your next go-to things after you get the food quality, after you get the food sensitivity, you get the carbs figured out? What is the next step that you...
Yeah. So after that, the next thing, there's a couple other lifestyle factors that I like to look at. A big one for me is sleep quality. And I say sleep quality, not sleep quantity, because I think there's a big difference between the two. A lot of times people think that just because they're getting, you know, 7-8 hours of sleep at night, that they're getting good sleep quality. I think that I talk to a lot of people who say that, you know, they have no energy, they feel exhausted in the morning, but they're sleeping 8 hours. So I think that, you know, not missing out on that that sleep and that sleep quality is something that can really hold people up. That can promote a lot of inflammation, that can limit your recovery. So I try to implement a lot of strategies for improving that, and just like little hacks, like, you know, putting your phone on nighttime mode, trying to remove blue light, sleeping with, you know, blackout curtains. You know, if you work out late at night, trying to do something to cool your body temperature a little bit after you work out so you don't stay up, you know, trying to consume less caffeine after 3 o'clock, which is actually kind of one of the places where I like to recommend plugging in exogenous ketones, is in that period where, you know, try to avoid that a lot of stimulants later in the day. So there's a few different factors I look at with that, but I think taking strategies to improve your sleep is something that we usually consider last. But I think for a lot of people, it can be one of the biggest things we need to do.
Yeah. So this is right in line with how I recommend to people and how I approach the same thing. So number one for me is food quality. And then number two is sleep. And so same exact for you. It's all about the quality and not necessarily the quantity. And the biggest thing that I found personally is with myself and people that I've worked with is you have to have a shut off time a couple hours before you're trying to actually go to bed. And shut off time means no devices and no stimulation.
Right.
It means, so for me, what that looks like is like I'm done with work about six or so and I have dinner. It's usually with friends or my girlfriend. And we, after that, I try not to look at a computer or at a device, period. I have my phone plugged in by my computer, which is downstairs in my house. My bedroom's upstairs. And I do not look at it after that point. And every night that I break that rule, I have terrible sleep and I track it with a ring. So like I know very well what that does to me. There's a lot of different things that you can do on top of that. Like you said, we have Philips Hue lights that dim into like a really dark orange and then shut off at 9 o'clock to kind of to emulate the sun and the sun setting. But I think that just generally getting away from this mental stimulation and always being on, I know that some people have extenuating circumstances where they can only work certain times or do whatever. And I totally appreciate that. But it's just, it's a thing that like we can, like devices, then the light that comes off of them is one thing. But I think just the overall mental stimulation that you get with devices is just not a normal thing. And I think that's actually underrated as opposed to just the screen brightness. And I think that getting that out of your life and just like actually calming down and doing something that's not output or input to excessive degree, whether that's reading or drawing or playing an instrument or talking to a friend or a loved one, like that is more important and that will get you ready for bed more than anything else. Now, another tip that I use with a lot of people that I had to do a lot when I had a lot of stuff going on, but it is like an excessive brain dump before you go to bed. And so what that looked like for me in the past was just taking a notebook and writing down every single thing that I knew I needed to get done and everything that was on my mind. And then that way my brain couldn't run in circles.
Right.
And so that was a huge strategy for me as well. But so those things just to me alone made a huge difference. I think an eye mask in general, like yes, blackout curtains, sure. But still I think that an eye mask typically is one of the best things that you can invest in to shut down and like stay asleep the entire night.
Right.
Those are my kind of top key tips.
Yeah. And I think, you know, another big one that I agree with you, I think the, you know, we're programmed with our phones and our computers and TV. Like it's programmed to be addictive. And when we watch these things or are staring at these screens late at night, it's very hard for our brains to turn off. Like you said, one of the strategies I started using to help turn it off for me was something that one of my good friends, Jake Rauch, who's getting ready to start his PhD, he had a recommendation. I don't remember where he got it from, but just starting to read like more fiction at night. I used to try to do a lot of reading at night, but it would be like science reading or business reading where it would kind of just more stimulate my mind than relax it. So once I started moving more to like fiction based reading, where it was a little bit, you know, more relaxing and less relatable and stuff, I found that I was able to calm down better. So that's a strategy that's worked really well for me. And kind of another really easy one that people can do, and I'm sure, you do this anyway, the fact that you leave your phone out, but sleeping with your phone facing up is kind of a big one. A lot of people don't realize that, you know, even when we're sleeping, our eyes can recognize that light, and that can drastically suppress our melatonin production. So even just having like flash, you know, they've done research where they found just flashing lights with in a room where people are sleeping can still impair circadian function. So I think that's another big one too. Like you hear a lot more where people are putting their phone in sleeves, or, you know, sleeping with them upside down, or sleeping with them outside of the room. I think that's just kind of an easy thing that everybody can do without having to give much effort, you know?
Yeah. Another top one. Cold yes. temperatures at night. I finally got my girlfriend on this. She wasn't a fan for a while, but yeah. Now that she realized how much better she sleeps, she's 100% on board. But yeah, this is one of the things, like, I think we set it at 66 or 67 is the thermostat that to kick on at like 8 PM.
Yeah.
And that's what's cranking in our bedroom until we wake up. And I think that's still even a little warm. I'd like to get to like 62, 63 even.
Yeah, I'm. That's one of the funny things about the difference between me and my wife is she just is on fire all the time, and like she's kind of one of those people where I'll come home and it'll be 76 at the house, and she'll be like wrapped in a blanket on the couch, like cold still. So that was one of the biggest things for us too. Is I kind of told her, I was like, you know, if we want to sleep better, you're gonna kind of have to get used to this temperature being a little bit cooler. But you're right. It's amazing. People who've never tried it, like if you just simply lowering your, I mean, it kind of matches circadian rhythms, right? Like typically if you were living outside, you would experience a change in temperature, and it'd probably be a drop in temperature as the evening comes. So really you're kind of just mimicking what would happen in nature. So I think it is a really big component. You're right.
Yeah. I mean that another one, so we'll just keep slamming away at sleep tips. But I think another one for me in general is, I and just electrolytes in general are great, but really pumping up the magnesium at nighttime for me is key. It just helps me relax everything, relax my tissues and really just calm out. And I think that, so one of the next things I think we'll probably get to is stress management, but also just going to bed and either reading until I'm a little sleepy or basically meditating until I fall asleep, which isn't ever long. And the thing is, like, if you don't fall asleep, well, great. Then you had a successful meditation and you won either way. If you fell asleep, then great. You fell asleep. So I think it's kind of a win-win either way.
Yeah, no, you're right. And I think that, you know, supplementation and sleep supplementation in general is a really interesting topic, because I feel that like electrolytes and like you said, magnesium in general, and I've noticed with like magnesium 3 and 8, that being a really effective one for improving my sleep. But I think that those are really great things to add in. I think, what a lot of people tend to do is they go for more of those supplements that just kind of knock you out, the ones that are going to more of give you sedation. And I listened to a podcast not long ago with, I think it was Matthew Walker, who I believe is a neuroscientist on sleep. And he talked a lot about kind of the differences between sedation and sleep. And a lot of times people who are just taking, you know, maybe you're just taking you know, some really heavy supplement that's going to knock you out, that might not necessarily mean that you're getting the most quality sleep. So I think that if you do supplementation, choosing the right ones and going for probably some of those more natural ones, like you said, with magnesium is definitely a better approach.
Okay. And so here's another question that I have for you is, like, do you recommend all this stuff at once, or do you phase people into this one at a time? When people ask me, I generally hit them with just with a full stack of, like, make sure that you are eating high quality food, make sure that you're moving and doing strength training, make sure that you're sleeping, and make sure that you are doing stress management. And those are kind of my big four. And then I say, like, just try mastering all those and then coming back to me. How do you go about this? Is it like stepwise function, or how are you helping people through this?
Yeah. So I like to take a step function for it for a couple of reasons. One is, again, my biggest thing is it's not always about what's most optimal. It's about what's most sustainable. So I try not to throw 100 changes at somebody at once. I want them to, you know, I like habit stacking, where, you know, this week we're going to focus on getting better with this, and then we're going to keep doing that, but next week we're going to get better with this. So I kind of like taking that approach. So like usually it's a week one, I'm looking at the most important things, which I think is, can we be working out more, or should we be working out, and what are our carbs looking like, our carb intake? And then, you know, once we kind of get that, we're looking at that, it's kind of moving into week two, where we're looking at sleep quality, food quality, stress, alcohol consumption, things like that, where it's habit stacking, you know. And for a lot of it, I don't usually recommend necessarily cutting everything out. Like for some people, it's more about doing an assessment and seeing, okay, if you're drinking alcohol 3 times a week, is there a way that we can tone that back to 1 time a week and use, you know, stick to a more keto friendly drink if you're going to do it? Or for dairy, you know, can we switch to only having it a few times a week, or can we switch to having a higher quality source, things like that? So I kind of tried to habit stack it. And really the big reason why I do that is I think that you're going to hit plateaus multiple times in your keto journey. And I think that if we exhaust all of the options for busting through that plateau initially, then we really have nowhere to go. So what I kind of like to do is like get those first things in check, like all those things that we just discussed, and then let yourself sit for like follow those things, do it for a few weeks, and then see what happens. And, you know, just cutting dairy or just adding exercise or just improving your food quality might be what you need to do to punch through that plateau. And if that's the case, keep doing those things, stick to it. And if you hit another plateau, then I kind of talk through like what are the next phases that you can do. So that's kind of the approach that I take, which may be a little bit different from what some other people do.
Yeah, you're just more patient than I am. That's the key.
Right.
So what haven't we covered that's the next step?
Yeah, so the next thing that I like to look at with people is their eating window. I think that that's a big thing where for a couple reasons. One is if you're somebody who is consuming a lot higher calories on keto, if we look at your eating window and we cut it down and we start incorporating some fasting, even if you're not tracking, what's probably going to happen is you're going to, you know, those calories are naturally going to lower a little bit, which I think can be helpful. But I think in general, if we go going through periods of fasting is just going to help with improving our insulin sensitivity, lowering our, you know, blood glucose levels, probably ramping up ketone production, and really kind of maybe even helping initiate some more fat burning. So that's kind of a big thing where if once we go through all these things, if you're somebody who is not fasting already, that's usually where I'll recommend starting to plug it in. And again, I kind of take a slow approach with this where if you're not fasting at all, you know, maybe the first week we just start by trying to get to 14 or 16 hours, you know, 1 or 2 days. Or maybe, you know, we start trying to do some alternate day fasting or, you know, some different strategies to kind of ease them into it. Or, you know, if you are somebody who's fasting, you know, is there a way that we can more optimize your fasting or switch your fasting protocol up? But that's usually the next thing that I like to look at because I think that there's quite a bit of power in fasting.
Got it. So I agree. However, one of the things that I tell people too, and I think this is something to be mindful of, is that if you're already fasting an excessive amount, maybe not fasting as much might be a good way to switch it up.
Yes.
Because fasting is a stress for your body. And sometimes your body has too many things going on and it can't focus on doing what it should be doing, which is providing you with the necessary energy burning that you need to reach your goals. And so sometimes adding in a breakfast when you're, especially if you're super hungry and not starving yourself and having more regular meals might be better than excessively fasting every single day. So I think that it probably goes the opposite way here. So if you're not really doing much of it, it probably is helpful to do so. But if you're doing an excessive amount or like you're fasting every other day or you're fasting 22-hour windows every single day and not getting results, that it might make sense. I've seen people have help actually splitting that up into meals throughout the day. Have you seen this at all?
Yes, definitely. I think it's. I also look at it similar to how I look at exercise too. Like if you're already exercising 6-7 days a week, chances are you probably benefit from pulling it back. Same thing with fasting. If you're already fasting 18 to 20 hours or doing the one meal a day approach 5 to 7 days a week, I think there's definitely some value to pulling that back a little bit and trying to ramp up metabolism or by incorporating, you know, a little bit more. Or having a little bit larger of an eating window. Usually what I'll tell people is to just one way to scale it back is if you've already pushed it far enough where you're at 5-6 days is just try to do every other day or 2 days on, 1 day off to start where, you know, because fasting, it's kind of a unique thing. Like fasting for me is something that I follow almost daily because of the improvements in like cognitive output. But you know, that's a different goal in mind than somebody who's doing it for weight loss. So, that's kind of something that people have to take into consideration too. Like, what is the goal that you're going for? In this case, if you're trying to bust through a plateau, then you're looking at, you know, trying to optimize your body composition. I think that there is a lot of value, like you said, to pulling it back. Sometimes people just need to be eating more calories. Like you said, there's a lot of stress on the body when we're fasting for 18 hours and we're working out for an hour a day, 6 days a week, and the normal stresses of our life. That's a lot. That's a lot of stuff to just be promoting a lot of inflammation in the body and limit recovery. So I definitely agree with you on that.
Okay. Next step.
Yeah. So next step, after that, as we're going through, I kind of like to revisit the calorie burning depending on where somebody is at. So if you're somebody who at the beginning, when we kind of went through this assessment, you weren't working out at all, and we started incorporating some, you know, low intensity, easy exercise, the next thing I like to do is start ramping that up. So again, see if we can, you know, increase our intensity where, you know, maybe you were just getting to the point where you were jogging a couple days a week. Well, can we change that to doing some more HIIT type training or some resistance training? So I kind of like to alongside of that eating window, is there room for us to change that training up again from where we were at the beginning? So that's kind of a mid-tier change. Really depends on the individual, a beginner versus somebody who's been training for a while. But I do think that that's kind of another important thing in the progression.
Yep. So yeah, I think that we talked about that a little bit before, but strength training and pushing that and building some foundational strength is not just good for increasing metabolism, stuff like that, but just as a signaling molecule to tell your body what to do.
Right.
And I think that that's a big thing that people are missing out on generally, is that they try to do. And when I mean strength training, and I think you probably mean the same thing too, is like not CrossFit. Like this is not the same thing as CrossFit, in my opinion. And I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, but like, what is strength training to you?
Well, that's a good question. I tend to call it resistance training more, because I think that I like to differentiate strength training as a type of resistance training that would be different from hypertrophy or different from CrossFit or things like that. So I kind of tend to classify strength training as, you know, as that's what your primary goal is you're trying to improve strength, which I think is what you're saying too. And what I think is an important component here, but I kind of phase that as a different phase of resistance training.
Got it. So what's next after that?
So, yeah. So after that, that's when, now keep in mind when, at the beginning of this assessment, kind of what matters is what you're doing currently. If you're somebody who's tracking or not tracking, that kind of plays a big role in this. But after you've made all of these changes, the next thing I start looking at is actually assessing your macronutrients and starting to make changes. The reason why I hold off on this for so long is because I like to, again, kind of help people adopt keto as a lifestyle, where I want you to understand macros and I want you to understand what's in what, you know, what kind of nutrients are in what foods. But I also want you to be able to eat intuitively. So I kind of try to take away as much emphasis on tracking unless we have to do it. So at this point, you know, if you've made it this far through the assessment, you know, you've given a couple weeks to each change and you still haven't seen results, chances are now we have to get a little bit more strict. So this, in the program that I put together, this kind of starts to fall into the final phase, the phase three, where it's a little bit more strict, where we're, you know, let's take a look at your macronutrients. Let's see how you've been eating recently and what we can do to change it. Because I've noticed that just switching it up can be a big difference for people. Like if you're somebody who's been consuming very traditional keto for a long time, 70%, 70 to 75% fat, 20 to 25% protein, you might benefit from, you know, if you're keto adapted, you may benefit from increasing that protein a little bit and dropping that fat down, maybe kind of going towards more of a modified Atkins approach. I think that that's kind of a good way to go about it. Or vice versa, if you're somebody who you've been following a high protein version of keto, which is becoming a lot more popular now, you might benefit from, you know, dropping that protein a bit and kind of getting back to traditional keto. So that's kind of the next stage, where it's just, let's assess your macronutrients and see if there's something we can do differently.
Got it. Do you see more people going from eating too little protein to then eating an adequate amount? This is kind of what I've seen a pattern of more so.
Yeah, I think it depends. If it's a new, so say it's like a newbie who started keto, they've been doing it for a little bit and then they hit their plateau and this is when they're going through this, then typically that's what it is that, you know, the traditional knowledge out there is keeping that protein extremely low. So a lot of times these are the people who are eating, you know, 180 to 220 grams of fat every day. Chances are if you've been doing keto for a while and you're adapted, and especially if you're at a little bit higher body fat percentage, you probably don't need to be consuming that much fat. You can probably increase that protein a bit to, you know, maybe increase your body's reliance on its own fat for burning. So that's typically the most common. But I am starting to see a lot of times if people are coming to me and they're more experienced ketogenic dieters, they've already kind of made that transition to going a little bit higher protein. We're starting to see that become pretty popular now, I think. So I think it really depends on where we get somebody in their stage of keto.
Got it. And so macronutrient wise and setting that, is there any general rule that you go for, we go for, you know, about, you know, limiting it to total between 30 and 50 grams of carbs, then doing about 0.8 to 1.0 grams per lean pound of body mass, and then filling in fat after that. What about you as far as your recommendations go?
Yeah, so I've been struggling with this for a long time, kind of wondering, trying to figure out where I stand. I think kind of my problem is I analyze the situation a little bit too in depth to make a definitive recommendation. But one of the things I like to do is I like to look at where they're coming from first, because I think that plays a big deal. Like, if regardless of what we think is the most optimal place for you to be with your macros, if you're what you've been consuming lately is probably what your body has adapted to. So I like to kind of start from there and then try to adjust it. So if I talk to somebody and, you know, they're consuming, you know, 1500 calories and 20% protein with that, their protein is really low. We just need to start improving it. So a lot of times with that, I'll just recommend, like, let's slowly start increasing that protein each week and lowering that fat a little bit. But I don't necessarily make specific recommendations on it just because I guess I feel that there's so many variables that it's hard to be definitive with it. The approach that you guys have, I think, is great because generally that's probably, as a rule of thumb, that's going to be pretty good for most people. But I just think there's so many factors that come into play.
Right. I think it's certainly individualized. Absolutely. And I think that people need to tinker to see what works for them. And that's one of the things that I try to say. Just when people look at macro calculators, it's a good starting point in general and a good generalized thing. But people are very much individuals and need to take things in a very individual approach.
Agreed. Definitely.
Okay. So besides that, I mean, what else have you used in terms of figuring out busting through plateaus and stuff like that, as far as, you know, any other like cheats or quick things that people can do that they're not doing?
Yeah. So as part of that, like, last phase, that's a little bit more in depth. One of the next things I like to look at is ketone and glucose testing. So what I recommend people doing is, like, learning when the appropriate time to test your ketones and glucose is to get a little bit of a baseline. And, you know, I'm a firm believer that we don't really know a whole lot about the most optimal ranges to be. But I think that testing your glucose and ketones in conjunction with assessing how you feel can kind of give you a pretty good idea of what's going on in your body. So, you know, if you're testing your glucose at the right time in the morning, which is, that's kind of important, is when you're testing. But if you test it at the right time in the morning and your glucose is consistently over 100, then, you know, or even in the upper 90s, that's probably something that we need to be addressing. So one of the biggest things that I'll usually say is, you know, one, fasting, I think, can really help with that. And then actually using the blood glucose support that you guys have is one of the things I recommend to people, is just taking that to help get that fasted glucose down. Because typically what we'll see is that if we get that glucose lower, or that glucose number to lower a little bit, we'll get that ketone level ramped up a little bit. So that's kind of one of the first things that I'll have them do. And then in terms of, like, interpreting their ketone results, if people have low ketone levels, I always kind of tell them that the first thing I think to look at is how you feel. So if you have low ketone levels in conjunction with low energy and, you know, mental fog and stuff like that, then chances are there's probably an issue. So in that case, I'll usually recommend, you know, maybe incorporating some exogenous ketones, getting some more MCTs in your diet, trying to train at a higher intensity to stimulate some more ketone production.
Let me pause you there. We have a really intense crew of people that come out of the woodwork and say that if you add any exogenous ketones or MCT oil, you will stop and halt fat burning immediately.
Right.
So you laugh immediately when I say that. So can you just break that down and that myth? Because I feel like when I try to speak on that, it's very tough because people think that I'm just trying to be a snake oil salesman and that I'm selling my products, but that's not the case at all. So please.
Yeah. So the thing that I always tell people who say that is, here's the thing. So when I was in grad school, I was testing ketone, different types of like just raw ketone powders and doing like different combinations of them in different amounts and testing blood levels and everything like that. And no matter what I would see is that when you took a baseline measurement, however, depending on the cocktail that you were putting together, at some point down the road, your levels would return back to baseline and they would continue at that baseline level regardless. So to me, if my ketones are 1.1 and I take exogenous ketone, if that's my baseline and I take exogenous ketones and they go up to 1.9, but then 4 hours later, they're back down to 1.1. I can't see how taking them stopped ketone production because my ketone levels never went to zero. So I think that it's kind of one of those things. I just haven't seen it. I haven't seen where somebody taking them has led to them just completely halting their ketone production. I understand the thought process behind it. What I do think maybe plays a bigger role is the amount of energy that's available to our body. So I think that, and I forget somebody wrote a great article about this a while back, but one of the things they talked about was, you know, if our body recognizes a ton of energy being available to it, like if say we have exogenous ketones and, you know, we just consumed a high fat meal and, you know, we have all this energy available, like, yeah, your body may slow down ketone production because there's no need for it. But to say that taking the supplement is going to directly just come in and halt ketone production, I just haven't seen the research on that yet.
What about fat loss in general?
Yeah, that's another big one. I think that way more research is necessary. But to me, I think that and we may have talked about this on the last episode that we were on, but I think what happens is a lot of people look at exogenous ketones and fat burning, and they look at it being cut and dry as does it or does it not stimulate fat burning? And I don't think it's that simple. I don't think that taking exogenous ketones right now and then going and working out is going to mean that right away you're burning more fat. But what it can mean is, one, you train harder in that training session because you have more energy, which could stimulate more fat burning. But what about kind of the long-term adaptations that occur? We know that ketones can help, you know, stimulate mitochondrial biogenesis, which is going to allow us to become more effective fat burners. So that's kind of the way that I look at it is no. Are they going to acutely increase fat burning? Probably not. But what is the long-term potentiation of taking them? And I think that that's where exogenous ketones can really stimulate some fat burning. And I know that there's some research too about like, you know, activating brown adipose tissue. They've shown that in some mice studies and stuff. So I just think that there's a lot of mechanisms that make it not as cut and dry as what people want it to be.
Got it. And I think that, it's so much more complex than at the moment that you're taking a product or supplement, like you're saying. So
Thank
you for speaking on that. And anything else that you think is worth mentioning as far as ways to break through a plateau?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that those are kind of that's a basic rundown of the things that I like to look at. I think that if you get to a point after that where you still haven't busted through your plateau, I think the next thing to look at is your calories. If you're somebody who's been consuming, you know, some people they see results consuming a ton of calories on keto because they're coming from a bad diet. And, you know, if you're somebody like that and you hit a plateau and your calories are still, you know, upwards in the upper 2000s and stuff, like chances are you can probably start to lower those and maybe see some results. But at this point, if you're consuming, you've already been consuming low calorie and these tips didn't work, that's usually where I'll recommend like taking some other approaches, like maybe going and getting like your thyroid tested, getting your hormones looked at, some different things like that. Because at that point, I think that if you've optimized your lifestyle and your food quality and your macros and your training and all of that stuff, chances are you probably have something a little bit more in depth going on that may need or require a little bit more testing.
Man, you are one step ahead of me with all this stuff. I was just going to say, like, okay, all that stuff is amazing, but if you don't get results after doing all that stuff and you're tweaking and actually going in progress, like we talked through this whole episode, then it's time to see an actual, I would say, functional medicine provider or a registered dietitian who knows a lot about this stuff and really dive in deep and get some testing done, because it's actually not that uncommon to have, you know, some type of hormonal problem going on or some type of adrenal issue or gut problem, which can delay a lot of these results. However, I think that it's way easier and way cheaper to go through all the stuff that we just talked about instead of going straight to there. I think that a lot of people think like, oh, well, I might have a crazy hormone imbalance, therefore I'm not getting the results I want. I'm going to go spend $4,000 in self-identify with this diagnosis of something. Let's strip it down and work easiest to hardest. And I think that's the hardest thing to figure out. So let's just figure out what we can and kind of work through this in a meaningful progression. And I think that we kind of laid it out in a really clean way.
Yeah, like, and I agree with that. And I think that's kind of my point with it, is that a lot of times I don't want people to get the perception that doing keto has to be so difficult. It has to be so strict. It has to be so hard to figure out what to do. So, or so expensive and things like that. So I always kind of try to recommend people, like, figure out what is the things you can do to tweak this diet to make it really fit with you and make it something you can follow long term. And if that doesn't work and we have to get more strict and, you know, you want to start seeing results again, then there are these other methods you could take. But kind of one closing thought on that I want to touch on is, if you're stuck at a plateau, one of the biggest things we tend to forget about is that keto isn't just about optimizing body composition. It's not all about aesthetics. So if you're somebody who you've been stuck, and I hear it all the time, you've been stuck at a plateau for 6 months, you haven't seen any progress. And if you start going through some sort of program to, you know, bust this plateau and you're still not seeing progress, don't get discouraged, because, you know, chances are you're still doing a lot of things to improve your health. You're improving your quality of life. You're improving your longevity. You're doing so many things that extend outside of just, you know, what you look like and what your body's like. So that's kind of an important thing that I think some people tend to forget about.
Phenomenal point, Chris.
Yeah. Thank you.
And do you have a way people can learn more about this, or what's the...
Yeah. So right now, actually, this plateau program that I put together, it's kind of a do-it-yourself program that you can go through this step-by-step, kind of like how I laid out in this podcast, and do some assessments and make changes. I actually finished writing that this last week. So I have my design teams kind of off getting it designed and looking good. So if you visit theketologist.com, you can find that program on there. And as well as some other content and everything. So that'd be, if you're somebody who's stuck at a plateau, that'd be a great place to start.
Awesome, man. Thank you for getting on a rant with me and me now having something to link to when people ask me every single day how they're stuck in a plateau and how to bust through it.
Right. Well, yeah, I hope it helps a lot of people. It's just one of those things where I think everybody, I told somebody this the other day, I think 99% of people who do keto will experience a plateau at some time. And I think that it's something that we just don't really know what to do. So hopefully this is something that gives people a little bit more hope that they can, you know, get the job done and start seeing results again.
Awesome. Appreciate it. Where else can people find you and your work?
So theketologist.com is, you know, something that I've been working hard to build out and make it looking good. That's been a little bit of a struggle because I'm more of a writer and stuff than I am a graphic designer. So check that out and give me your feedback on that. And then Instagram is kind of the other place. If you have questions, I'm pretty responsive in the direct messages there and put out a lot of content there. So Instagram and the website would be the two best spots.
All right. Appreciate it, Chris.
All right. Thanks a lot, Dr. Gustin. Appreciate it.
All right, everyone. Thanks for listening to another episode of the Keto Answers podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. But even if you didn't, I would love a review. Just go over to iTunes, wherever you listen to your podcast, and pop in a review so we can get found by more people, get better guests, and have the information that you need. So please go to iTunes, wherever you listen to your podcast, and leave us a review. And if you're new to keto, head on over to perfectketo.com/podcast and enter your email for all our top tips and guides on getting started with the ketogenic diet. Thanks, and we'll see you next time.